Hello, I'm Josephine Sellers, and I'd like to welcome you back to the Awakening TV channel. It's my great pleasure today to be interviewing Roy and Ann Procter. Roy and Ann are authors of Healing Sick Houses. I have a fascination for the subject they work in, and I'm sure that the viewers are going to find what they hear enlightening and helpful. So welcome, Roy and Ann. It's a great pleasure. Yep. Thank you for inviting me here too.
Well, thank you for coming.
And I can't wait to hear what you've got to say. So you heal sick houses, and I want to know, why do houses need healing?
The energies of place are very important to the health of people who are there. In essence, we've got a life force or a spirit or whatever which is intimately connected with the physical. And if that life force is interfered with unsatisfactorily, then the people are not comfortable, or their health eventually can go down. So some people call this earth, we call it earth energies, but some people call it geopathic stress, some people call it black stream, some people just think it's water under the house, and pick up on that a bit later. But if you're living in a place where the quality of these energies is going to drain your life force, then you may not have quite enough for yourself, so to speak. I mean, it's like if you're having a bath and you pull the plug out, you're not very satisfactory bath. You might turn the taps on full, but it may or may not overcome the rate at which it's falling out. So that's really what it's all about, to try and help people live in an environment where the energies are conducive to them developing and being happy, and avoiding those places which are deleterious to them, which can result in quite a lot of illness and things, yes, eventually, possibly.
Yes. So I'm going to ask you, how do you go about this work?
I haven't. Could I share a little bit more about the previous question?
Yes, absolutely.
Because I've got an analogy about it too.
All right. Yes, I'd like to hear your take on it, Anne, yes, as well.
Well, I think it's rather like when your the boot light in your car stays on when you shut the boot. You know, when you open the boot, the lighter comes on.
Yes.
You shut the lid, it should go off. So it's draining the battery all the time if it stays on.
Yes.
And that's rather like what happens when people are living in a geopathic stress sort of way.
Because you can't see that it's gone.
You can't see that it's... You don't know that that's happened.
Energy drain.
No.
And you don't feel right.
That's right. So anybody can have as much healing or of any kind, but if the boot light's still on, the battery will still go flat.
Out the other way.
You know that sickening feeling when you go outside one morning?
Absolutely. No, I think that's a brilliant analogy, and I would understand that and have experienced that, and it can be quite awesome, and there is such a need for people to understand.
People do sense this sometimes, just not realising what it's about. They go into a place and they don't like this. You go into somewhere else. I mean, one place I really go for is Wells Cathedral. Yeah. If you stand in the middle of the crossing, you know, you feel totally uplifted. So there's ups as well as downs.
Yes,
and we've noticed it with people who are viewing houses with a view to buying them.
Yeah,
they say, just don't like it.
No.
It's nothing to do with the colour of the wallpaper or whether there's a decent garden or anything. It's no. And we've been asked to review places before people buy them.
What a good idea.
And we have actually sometimes people selling them. Yes. And as soon as we've done the work on them,
they sell.
Well, the most dramatic case is we did one that hadn't sold for 2 years and it sold for cash the next day. But that was a bit excessive.
No. We mustn't count on that. All right.
So we have got an instinct in us that tells us, but we sometimes don't know how
to deal with it.
So you go in and you can back that up for the client.
Yes, indeed. So. You said how do we go about it?
Yeah, so how
well,
do you
we get lots and lots of different inquiries, apart from people who are viewing houses or trying to sell houses. People are realising there's something wrong. So we set about it initially by just dowsing the address.
Yeah.
That's the first thing we do, because we can tell then whether it's something that we can do.
Basically, what we do is we take the address as a focus, as a first inquiry.
Yes.
I just use a pendulum and Anne tunes in at the same time. And as you know, a pendulum will give you just straight yes or no answers, depending, and you have to find your own questions. Mm. So through that process, we find out whether broadly what the energy situation of that place is and the factors affecting. And if it's something within our scope that we think we can deal with, then we will ask for a sketch plan of the ground floor of the house. We prefer that to be a drawn sketch. It doesn't have to be to scale, and some of them are absolutely appalling, but they're very often a better focus to tune into the situation than a machine-drawn thing. People would like to send us the estate agent's little plans, you know. Mm. Well, we can work for them, but it's not so good, put it that way. So if we then get the sketch plan, if that's the next stage, then we will again use the that plan and by dowsing and using a ruler on that plan, we will find where the energy lines are.
Yeah.
We see them as lines.
Yes.
We see them as straight lines. People will argue about that, but it works for us, so that's the only thing that's really important. These energies appear to have a direction of flow, so we need to know that. They also have a quality.
Yes.
In other words, are they beneficial or deleterious? We call them positive or negative, just as our shorthand. And so then we find that lot out, and when we've got it all sorted out on the paper and in our minds and understand the situation pretty thoroughly. And I must make the point here that with dowsing, for this sort of thing, or nearly anything, you must ask very, very clear, unambiguous questions. And it's got to be simple questions with a yes or no answer.
Yeah.
And that's where I think part of our success comes from as an engineer. I want to be precise and get it right and spot the anomalies and that they make sure it's a good bit of logic. So it's a combination of intellectual logic and switching to receiving the intuitive answer. So it's a flip-flop business, and you've got to be good at both bits.
I was always told, ask a woolly question, get a woolly answer.
Well, that's absolutely
by a great
right.
dowser.
So having done all that, the actual business of healing is we use what we call a very tightly focused meditative process for spiritual healing. And what we're seeking to do there is not block or divert, which some people talk about. We're seeking to transmute the quality of that line from unhelpful to helpful. So if you go and douse after we've done our work, you'll find they're all still there. But hopefully you'll find that the quality of them is now beneficial to people there. We don't really...
Through healing and transmutation.
Healing and transmuting, that's what it's all about, yes.
And other people who do this kind of work do it differently. And that's absolutely fine.
Yeah.
They're inclined actually sort of to get argumentative about it. And we say, well, if it works, why bother? You know, because it's an individual thing and it's grown out of nothing, really,
in
quite fairly recent times.
Yes.
So why not everybody try to do the thing that works for them and see where we go from there?
Yes, absolutely.
So that's how it's
diversion's how it is. Always slightly worried me. Because where are you dividing it to if you use the other...
Very good point.
Exactly.
You know, are we being responsible here?
Yes.
And the ultimate process is transmutation.
I believe that too. Definitely.
I'm very worried when people divert. Poor person down the road. Maybe. I don't know.
Yes, could do.
Well, they're just working on the intellectual and mechanical plan without the sort of, shall we say, the spiritual component.
And the healing potential that we have.
Yes.
Yes.
At least that's our view.
So, is there any more?
No.
So, you were asking how do people know they've benefited from it. You did talk about someone who sold a house, but we don't want to go along those lines so much. It's about feedback.
That's a bit rare.
Yes, it's about feedback, isn't it?
Well, we get lots of feedback.
I'm sure
lots
you do.
Lots and lots of feedback. And, in fact, you know, we wouldn't have been doing it all these years.
No, I know.
If nobody said anything or everybody said, oh, nothing's happened. Mm. They write enthusiastically or... and so we encourage to continue that way. And most of our inquiries are sort of word of mouth.
Yes.
Friends of friends, people say, oh, well, your house, you know, you having trouble, why don't you try the Procters, that sort of thing. And there are also quite a large number now of therapists who find that they're not getting very far, that they, whatever they're doing for the patient is going down the drain, or the boot light's still on.
I like that one. I'm going to remember that one. I like that.
Good. So they say, right, well, try the Procters and see if there's any energies there that are draining you. And then they notice that their particular therapy works better.
So they get
that problem again, so they send somebody else.
So that's how I came to you, because I just put out a question when I was with a group of friends a few weeks ago at supper that all the people I know have left the world who have worked with me over the years, and I need someone who really works well with energies on sites. And your name came up, and I had so many anecdotal stories that so impressed me. I thought, well, I'm going to look them up and go and find them. So that's how I've ended up here. So that's come off the back of anecdotal stories.
Yes, well, it is all anecdotal. So, anyway, this business of anecdotal, you see, that doesn't go down very well with people who are all in the head.
Scientific.
So we thought, well, perhaps we could do some research. So we got all these files. We've done over 8,000 cases now. At that stage, we hadn't done quite so many. We've had to shred a whole lot of the old ones because we thought the ceiling would fall down. Well, anyway, at that stage, we were saying perhaps some PhD student would like to go through our files and see what they could find out of it. And nobody was interested, and we kept mentioning it on our courses, and nothing happened. And then we had a young woman who was a statistician at Cardiff University on the courses. She was very funny because she wasn't quite, you know, she didn't think that it was quite on to do dowsing. She'd come, but, and she was like on the edge of a flat earth. You know, everything, this was all right. And then she looked into dowsing, which was like going over the edge of the flat earth.
Yes.
But actually, we won her over. I mean, it wasn't difficult. She really got into it, and that was wonderful.
She did very well.
She did very well, yes. And she said, well, I could do some research. I don't think this, what do you call it, not retrograde, looking at files you've already got is really very valid. We need to send out questionnaires and things.
Okay.
A statistician, so I believed her. I mean, they say there are lies, damn lies, and statistics, but some people will take more notice if you've got statistics. So we set about it with her. She was very cooperative about getting the protocol together. She and I did a lot of work on the right sort of questions and how to send the right sort of questionnaires. I won't go into all the detail. She collected and assessed the results.
Yes.
So it was... there was a lot of sort of double blind and all that sort of stuff in it.
True research.
It was pretty proper.
Yes, yeah.
And you've got a thing about the results, haven't you, Roy, somewhere?
Well, yes. We found, basically, the research looked at... the questionnaire was filled out by the people, which was about 20 things to try and establish their sort of senses and feelings. It was sent out before we did anything... Some went out shortly after we'd done something, and I think another lot went out at a month, wasn't it?
Well, some were before, because and that coped with the placebo effect.
Yes, that's right. Some were before, some after, and we did them at two months, see if it had maintained. Well, the 2 month result, 80% of the people expressed beneficial results. We sent out... We looked at 150 cases. That was the size of the sample, of which we got full reply to all four questionnaires from 105.
That's good.
So we got a 70% response rate, which the statistician found was absolutely astonishing.
Yes, yeah.
And she said the sort of 20s to 30s were the sort of general level of that sort of work, which she'd been doing with trade unions and other groups and things.
She'd done some health ones.
So that sounds like good qualitative research.
Yes.
So we got a response rate of 70%, and 80% of the people said they'd benefited. We then presented the results at an international congress in Manchester. I've forgotten when that was, about 2003, I think that was. And it was very well received. The results were published in the Dowsing Today magazine, which can probably be found a back copy of that through the British Society of Dowsers. But I think it's worth saying that none of this is very new, actually, because there was a chap called Fritter von Pohl, who was an Austrian, and he published a book, Earth Currents, Causative Factor of Disease cancer and other diseases. And when was that?
1932. Yeah, that's just there we
are. And it's a very, very full book, and he did all sorts of dowsing and sure where the energies were and all that sort of thing, you know.
Yeah.
It's somehow very it's convincing, but
we've been blocked, haven't we? Somehow
it's flat Earth.
It's yes.
Don't want to go over the edge of this all this scientific paradigm.
So we've known all these things. We've just
well, in some parts of Europe, I think Poland and that sort of places, a dowsing assessment is part of a dowsing assessment of the energies of the place is part of the normal purchase process for surveying houses. Yes.
And other cultures in the world wouldn't dream of going anywhere unless they'd sort this out first, would they? There we are.
Nor would we, incidentally, but that's not not typical.
I know you've been doing it for 30 years, but I'd quite like to know how you came into it in the first place. What brought you this way?
Well, it started with her, really.
Well, I had some number of psychic experience way back, some of them pretty scary, and I think you understand about such things. It led me into healing. I had did a lot of work at the College of Psychic Studies in London. Yes. Wonderful organisation. Yes. Paul Beard was the president at that time, and he was a very helpful fellow. So I managed to apprentice myself to various healers. Harry Edwards was one of them, so it was wonderful.
My childhood was with Harry Edwards in his healing sanctuary. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes. Various others. And one of the sort of chief ones was Bruce McManaway, who's a Scottish healer.
Yes.
I went on some workshops and events with him and sort of I managed to get myself involved in some sort of apprentice scheme. I went up to London once a month or something. He had borrowed somebody's house, you know, so I was well in with it. He had a summer school, which I went on, and that's when he started introducing this earth energy thing. Which was very interesting, and I came home and told Roy about it. Of course, at that stage, we really had, one of us had to be at home because the children were quite small.
Yeah.
And also we were both working and all that sort of thing. So I learnt about energies of place, he taught me to douse before that summer school. And that was another thing that puzzled you, wasn't it? Big way.
Yes.
I think he thought I was going off a bit.
Well, go on. Well, I was, because apart from what she said, we were also attending lots of Recon Trust events, and we were also
Sir George Trevelyan.
Oh, yes.
Another old friend of mine.
Yes. Well, yes. I'll go off an attack if you aren't careful. But where was I? Yes, Recon Trust.
Yes.
And we were also members of the Theosophical Society because their lodge was just around the corner from where we lived in Camberley at that time. So I was trying to comprehend all these experiences that Anne was having and what she was doing. And I really wasn't getting anywhere. And one of the great clues to success, from my point of view, well, pointers towards success, was that after one of our endless intellectual discussions, because she's very good at the intellectual bit as well, she says, oh, cool, you'll never understand this, you have to experience it, you can't do it intellectually. Mm. And so I said, well, I'm not a sensitive, so, you know, that's the end of that sort of hard luck. But one of the things that happened very shortly after that was I went to a Recon Trust do up at Stroud, Hawkwood, and sat down. In fact, it was one of the first ones I seem to remember.
We were very raw recruits.
Yes, we were very raw recruits. Anyway, we sat down at a table, as one does, and it was dark on the Friday night before the started. And there was an old gentleman at the table who I didn't know, and he just turned to me and said, oh, you can use a pendulum, can't you? And I said, no. And he said, oh, yes, you can. And I said, no, I can't. He says, I'll show you. And it took him about 3 or 4 minutes using, I think, a necklace or something to say, well, you can get a yes, you can get a no, can't you? And I could. So he said, well, you can get a yes and no, so you've got the system, you've got a good clear responses. If you shuffled your chair about, then you could arrange to point north, couldn't you? I said, well, conceptually, yes, and went shuffle, 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 wave, 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 you see. And I said, well, if that means anything, North's over there. Mm. And he fished in his pocket, pulled out a little pocket compass, put it on the table. Good God, I was dead right. He said, told you to use a pendulum, put the pocket thing back in his pocket and went and got another bicky or something. And I was left absolutely gobsmacked. The whole point then was I did a lot of practicing and walking around and finding earth energy lines and all that.
Not finding the mains water.
And not finding the water. That was quite irritating. I couldn't find the water main, but I could find earth energy lines like the clappers. And it was really a case of, well, I'm doing all this practicing. What on earth is the point of it? And then Anne went off on the next summer school the following year with Bruce. And I said, I want to come. And she says, oh, no, you can't do that because, you know, it's only for experienced healers. And I said, don't care. And he said, well, it's going to cost money. And I said, don't care, hard luck overdraft. And then she says, well, perhaps Bruce won't have you.
So I didn't put it quite.
So she rang up Bruce, and Bruce said, that's perfectly all right, I'll put a double bed in your room.
You could hear him pedaling on the other end of the phone.
And then she said, what about the work? I was head of department at that time in aerospace, and I said, well, I'm just going to tell him I'm not coming next week, which is exactly what I did. And there he went through this business of earth energies. We had exercises in that, amongst other things that he did. And his encouragement of me and my finding out, I was absolutely accurate, far better than anybody else on the course, at that particular thing.
At earth energies.
Yeah, and earth energies.
So. And maybe that hugely analytical and preciseness.
It does help.
It does.
So this is the balance in the relationship at work, isn't
so
it?
So we went home and said, well, you know, that was very interesting. I wonder what happens now. And then people just started to say, oh, I hear you can deal with black streams, you know, things go bump in our house. Can you come and help?
Sometimes that's really wonderful, isn't it? Because it really keeps the feet on the ground, doesn't it?
Yeah.
When you hit those things, it can feel so amazing. They can lift you off the ground, and so that balance is why it works. Yes. So that's how it all began.
And
people started to invite you because they knew what you could do.
Yeah, how they knew that, I don't know. That's the interesting thing about it.
How they knew that you could do it.
We weren't telling anybody.
Well, we won't go into those realms because we might come a bit off the ground there, mightn't we?
We might, yes.
So you've obviously from then on developed your skills to a high level.
Well, we keep learning, that's for sure. But to begin with, we did what Bruce had told us, which was to map Dowse to get a view of the thing and then go to the place and find the lines where they were. But
one of the reasons for the map dowsing was to stand where the lines weren't because they'd affect the dowsing.
If you stood on the line, you see, when you were dowsing, that would upset things.
Yeah.
So we got it all sorted out on the map, and then we'd go to the place. And we find out exactly where the line was on the ground, and then his instruction was about sticking a metal pole in the ground on the centre of the line where it entered the property.
Yes.
So we did. We collected old scaffold poles and had them in the boot of the car with a
sledgehammer,
one of those big heavy things. Yes. So we did quite a few like that,
marking the line.
Well, it was to transform it.
Oh, you see,
with healing intent, and when you bang with a great big thing, with hammer like that, you are intending something.
Yes.
It's quite hard work.
Yeah.
So that was his way of doing it at that stage.
In those days,
so we followed what he did, and we went all over the place. Well, the trouble was we got more and more inquiries, and we were working, we got the family, and how do you do it all, you know, time and space and all that sort of thing. And after all, we do live in time and space.
Yes.
I had to tell upstairs that sometimes. So we decided, we had a lot of thinks about it, and, well, you can do distant healing for people, so why not do it for places? So when the next few people asked, we said, well, we'd like to try this for you, if you don't mind. So we got the map, as usual, and then we did this focused business, and it worked. And it kept on working.
Well, so we went to the place and...
We'd go to the place and make sure that it was all right to begin with, sort of testing.
Yes, yes.
But it was, so there we were. And so we, ever since then...
You've been distance working?
We've been distance
working. As in distance healing, which indeed. I had so much evidence of in childhood at distant healing. It's very potent.
It really works.
And I also know a lot of body therapists who will... work at distance on the body and on my own horses. Yes. So it works. We know it works. I know it works.
Well,
and
been,
you know it works.
It's been working for, I don't know, several thousand
How
cases.
Wonderful. That's wonderful.
It means so, you see, that people can actually inquire from anywhere. Australia,
yes,
America,
you
know, Timbuktu, North Pole,
that's
if they want to.
So you can work for so many more people than you can.
Exactly.
Wonderful.
And of course, now there's email, it's easier to communicate with them.
Yes.
It wasn't to begin with all these letters going AML here, there,
and
everywhere.
I must say, I haven't met many people who do that work at distance.
Right.
So that's great.
No, there's less of that about. Most people who do this
go on
visit.
Site. I'm very impressed to hear this. I think this is
well, we
wonderful.
Developed it not long after we came to live here because we that's were right. finding we just couldn't
you
catch
can't.
Up with it all.
No.
So
wonderful.
We've been here 28 years now, so it's been going for some time.
That's brilliant.
Right.
I'm quite enlightened to hear that one today, and I'm encouraged by that.
Good.
Really encouraged by that. I think that's... big gem to take from that.
Mm-hmm. Well, there were further developments.
Well, yeah, there were. I think the point was that a number of people used to approach us for help because they were unhappy with things going thump in the night and, you know, that sort of thing, evidences of things they didn't understand.
Yes.
And when we changed transmuted the earth energies, those things stopped.
Wonderful.
And that seemed to be very good, and that went on for a bit. But after a bit, it were one or two cases that didn't stop.
Okay.
And we tried, and it didn't stop. And that said to us, look, folks, you're missing something. What is it?
Yeah.
Well, with dowsing and trying to tune in and all the things that one does to try to solve it, what it emerged was that the things that go bump in the night very often... were discarnates who had been living but hadn't found their way to the light or whatever you like to use, and they were trying to manifest to this level.
Yes.
And they often didn't understand they hadn't got bodies, couldn't understand why they couldn't get a response. Some of them started throwing the furniture about and so on and so forth until the poltergeist.
I've met much of this.
You know about
yes,
that
I do,
yourself,
so I'm
I
fascinated
know.
To hear you talking about this.
Mm. So we realised that actually all this was the discarnate saying, help! So we
Most
then
of them, anyway.
Thought, well, what do we do about that? And we had found through some... other events, which I won't go into unless Anne wants to expand on them, that when people are near death, you very often find some other person who has died, quotes, coming across to get them and help them.
Yes.
And so we thought, well, that's the way to go about it. So then we would try and tune in and try to invite some of the upstairs to come and help this person. And that seemed to work very well. We now don't choose a specific person, which we did, who we, quote, knew in the early days. We now call on the divine source and the beings of light to find this person and help it. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of our work is involved not only with the earth energies, but also helping
Wonderful.
These sorts of things.
Wonderful.
And I know that quite a number of people are into spirit release and that sort of thing. It's not always totally successful if you don't do the earth energies as well.
I understand.
And
that.
If you do the earth energies without checking that there are some other people confusing the issue, should we say, discarnates, or even nature spirits and things who are just wanting to be mischievous. So you've got to look into all that as well. And the two are intimately connected.
So
and I don't think there are so many people
no,
seeing
I
the connection
think you're
between
right.
the two.
There's usually one or the other.
That's right.
And
it's not a complete
no,
job.
No, it's got to be eclectic. It's got to be holistic. You've got to do body, mind, spirit, earth.
Well, one of the interesting things we found on our courses was that we did have a number of feng shui practitioners who came. And they were introduced to the idea that apart from all the things that they do in the house, actually you've got to pay attention to the underlying energies as well. And we were asked to go to Paris and start running a lot of courses on Dowsing for them, but it was all too difficult, so we didn't do it.
But this releasing spirits and things is sort of growing in our understanding of people. There's a Spirit Release Foundation.
Yes,
I don't know if you've heard
of
them.
I do.
Yes. Well, we were invited to join when they began. It was a retired psychiatrist who started it, which I thought was rather interesting way of going into it. And he's been able to spread the word in psychology and psychiatry, which is...
I know you're a psychotherapist yourself.
Yes. And so it's been very rewarding for me to see this sort of getting in more and more into the mainstream. It's early days yet,
yes.
But at least, you know, it is taken into account by some of the people who are working in that area. Another thing we found pretty early on, actually, is something we call power objects.
Yes.
Nothing to do with electrical power. That sometimes people have in their houses an object which has a very strong energy to it. I'm sure you have met with this. And it's dragging them down in a very similar way to the earth energies, either because it's an association of theirs, you know, it's a picture of some dead person who they didn't get on with or something happened, or perhaps some artifact that's come in with an energy there. Well, the ultimate of that would be a sort of carving from Africa, which the witch doctor had had a go at. We have found one or two of those.
Well,
they need to be burned.
Yes.
That sword, do you remember? Sword.
Yes. There were things like that. And so how do we find, you know, we need to help people to deal with that.
Yes. Yeah.
Usually some kind of ritual disposal is better, but for some people value whatever it is, so we have to work with that. The way we deal with it, you know, practically, is to douse on the map where the whereabouts, you know, is it in the sitting room, is it in the dining room, is it in the kitchen, on the map.
Yes.
And then by arrangement, I talk with the client while Roy's busy pendling.
Yes, yeah.
On the phone.
On the phone. And then we can say, well, if you look towards the window wall, what's there that might be significant? And we might actually have to tell, you know, say is the top drawer, the middle drawer, the second drawer, you know, and get them to take the drawer out and take it to pieces. But very often, as soon as you point them in the right direction, oh, is it that picture of my grandma? Or is it that vase I got from so-and-so, you know?
Wonderful.
So then we discuss with them what to do about it.
Yes.
We found out that in about 10% of cases, I think, was there's a power object of some sort.
I was just reminded you not to let your voice drop to nearly nothing towards the end of some of your dissertations.
Oh, right. I've been told how to do it sometimes. Okay, well, you go on about water then.
Oh,
then you
yes.
can speak up.
Well, I touched on water earlier, and why I wanted to bring up water here was that a lot of people say, oh, well, you know, this isn't a good house because it's got a stream of water underneath it. And then they ask for a dowser to do something. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's an assumption on a large number of people that water is under house bad news, full stop.
I would agree. I've heard that said a lot.
There is a lot of it about, but it isn't the water, it's the energy in the water. So it may or may not be anything to do with the water, because the earth energies may be coincident with and carried by water, or they may be in other places. So we're not really very interested in physical water, but we are interested in any energy qualities. So you don't have to ask for the water. What you're asking for is the energy.
The quality of the water.
And the quality...
Yes.
I think that the reason for this great connection is because, oh, well, dowsers are people who find water.
Yes.
And therefore, they're finding water, and that's what's wrong with the place, not recognising the energetic aspects.
It's working. It's coming.
Yes, it's working. I mean, an analogy of this is that water has a memory, according to various people recently.
Yes.
I see it like a tape recorder. And so you can impress on a tape recorder the information. And if you actually want to hear a piece of music, which happens to be on a tape, you don't ask for the tape. You ask to hear the music. And it's the same
Absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely.
The water is like
it's
tape.
The recording.
They're not really interested in the tape, and it doesn't matter whether it's a thin one or a fat one or whatever, as long as it's doing its job, so to speak, and doing a recording.
Yes, I understand.
It's the recording that you're interested in. One of the more newer things that we have to now pay attention to, of course, is this dreaded business of electrosmog.
Yes.
And we are finding there's hardly a place that we look at that is now not affected. And bear in mind that we're not just asking for, is there a presence of electrosmog? Mm. All our effort is trying to look to see whether the energies we're looking at are compatible with the person or the people in that house. So it's a matching, not an absolute thing. Mm. So if there are some power wires running a slap across the top of the house and the people are not adversely affected by them, then we don't get a response. But so one needs to bear that thought in mind, because people have different reactions to them.
Yes.
But the way that houses are now being filled with wireless devices, decked telephones are a disaster because they're in the house and radiating all the time. We have decked phones, but they're the sort that only radiate when you pick them up. And we will pick them up and very often say, well, after that, going to another phone, pick up a landline, put that one down to cut out the radiation. It can be very significant. So what do we do about it? Well, all you can do really is sort of warn people of the problem.
Well, yes, I mean, it gets denied that there's any problem. And, you know, people say, oh, there's this research that says it's perfectly safe and all that. Well, that's usually paid for by the people.
Of course it would.
But there's a lot of research available now, masses and masses that say there's potential harm here. So at the moment, we've decided not to try and keep up with it all. I mean, the technology is rapidly expanding.
Yes.
And we're 80, so we can't really keep up with all this stuff. So we offer some suggestions about reducing exposure to it.
What's that about? How do you do that? What sort of suggestions would you have? Just
Wally's been really talking about
personal
you know,
care.
It's very difficult to get convince people.
Yes.
Oh, well, you know, I don't feel an effect. Well, say the same thing about people who used to smoke 30 years ago. Now they die of lung cancer. It's cumulative. Now you think, well, these kids going about with mobile phones
really
in their pockets.
Really worrying. Really worrying. And
really
not using
their
microphones and holding them right close to their brains.
And then people go around with these Bluetooth things stuck in their ear.
Yeah, it's not
Now, hang on, he's on his soapbox.
Right, we'll stop
that.
Well,
yeah,
I do get
on it. But there is so much research available on the net, which is totally ignored.
Yes, I would agree. Well, it's all in small print on the mobile phone. So the most important thing, you've talked about not being, you know, you can't do it all and you can't get into it all, but what are you doing about handing on this knowledge?
Well, as far as the electrosmog is concerned, there are now experts who will help people out, you know, electronically, as opposed, which we can't do. Teaching other people about the healing sick houses, that's what you meant?
Yes.
Well, we did make a gentle start about 30 years ago, and the demand built up. I can only say it that way.
Yes.
There was very little available at that time of Dowsing, let alone what we were doing. Really, if you wanted to find out about healing sick houses, you went to Bruce. That's what it amounted to.
Yes.
And then it built up pretty quickly because there was a lack of availability. We were doing, about 6 courses a year for dowsing and 4 for ongoing people. We had to get them dowsing first to do the healing sick houses until about 3 years ago. And then I'm afraid we had to bow to waning stamina. And my mobility is not all that good, but in our later 70s we found doing a full day, giving of our best, was getting a bit of a strain, big strain. And also, of course, we had to sort of arrange the house for the course and retrieve it afterwards.
Yes.
And there was the admin.
And there was all the bookings.
The muddle that people
the messings about.
That is incredible.
People are very good at making muddles over bookings and things. Very good. So we said, OK, it's time we packed that bit of our work out. We wanted to continue with the actual person, you know, the work they do in the individual houses. Yes. And there were more people doing this kind of healing sick houses work by that time. So we said, right, well, you know, let that bit go. We do occasionally do some individual tuition people who just want to sort of catch up with us, who are into it in some way and have got some extra questions or want to meet with us. So we can do that occasionally. But it is available.
Well, I think the only source that we know of is that the British Society of Dowsers has significantly increased its educational arrangements. I think that there are some there that probably know how to do this properly.
Yes.
And they've got a professional register which is available on their website.
So
and if you look under, I think it's geopathic stress or something, you'll find those people who do this type of work.
Yes.
I can't vouch for that they do it to the way that we do it, because different people have different needs. Nor would I vouch for the fact that they're covering the whole range, which yours mentioned.
Is a very holistic approach, but they can go into the British Society.
They can go into the British Society.
And there are different Dowsers, and there's areas, aren't there? Mm.
Well, we have taught quite a lot of people, and we do know that some of them are doing it along our lines, but very often I can only think of one person who still does it as an activity, so to speak. Nearly all the others are incorporating it, as far as we know, into their own practice, whether they're homeopaths or whatever they are, massage people and things like that.
So there is somewhere there is.
But there's two separate things here to go for to the BSD for. One is tuition, and the other is to get some help with a healing sick for a sick house. So either of those, you can go to their website.
Well, we'll make sure that we make that available on the film.
Okay,
so
good.
Can see. And
that's
I just
fine.
Want to once again say, this is Anne and Roy's book, Healing Sick Houses. And I think I've taken all the information I can from you today.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
For coming. Thank you for sharing it. And I really just hope that it goes out and it helps people and they know there's somewhere they can go for help. Thank you.
Thank you.